Well, good morning and welcome to Woodlands Church. Welcome if you're watching with us online right now, or if you're catching up during the week. And welcome to everyone in the building. You know, every Sunday for me is a little bit like a reunion, because every Sunday there are people who I haven't seen in person for a really long time, and they're here in church. And it's great to have caught up with some old friends today who it's been months since we've really met in person. But whether you're here every Sunday or intermittently, whether you're just here for the first time, whether you're watching online, we hope that you'll have a brilliant time with us today, that you'll be able to enjoy worship, you'll be able to connect with people who want to welcome you, but more important than that, you'll be able to connect with God himself. Because when we gather together, we don't just welcome one another, we welcome the presence of God with us. And so in a moment or two, we're going to start in worship. Just introduce myself. If you've not met me, my name's David. I'm the senior leader at Woodlands. The senior leader at Woodlands here, the congregation to meet in this building. And I'd love to catch up with you, particularly if you're new. And during the service at the end, there'll be a real opportunity for people who are new and would like to connect with us to say more. But without any more ado, I'm going to pray. Then I'm going to hand over to my friend, colleague and housemate, Tibbs, who's going to be leading our worship today. So if you're able to, you'd like to just stand with me. I'm going to pray. Father God, we honour you and we love you. And as we sing songs of praise and as we talk about you today, as we listen to people preaching, as we greet one another, we pray that in all those things we find your goodness is here. Amen.
Some heralds.
Sing, hark the herald angels sing. Hark the herald angels sing. Glory to the newborn King. Peace on earth and mercy mild. God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise. Join the triumph of the sky.
Thank you.
right, you guys are going to help us out with these actions, okay? You ready?
Came to see the baby, stood by his mother's side. He laid a savior inside a manger. Oh, what a glorious night. Oh, what a glorious night. I hear the angels singing, hallelujah, let the earth receive her King. Our earth and love has come, singing out, Jesus Christ is born. Oh, Jesus Christ is born. Hey.
Let's sing the shepherd's wonder.
The shepherd's wonder, they couldn't hide it, told everyone inside. All were amazed when they heard how God came down on that glorious night. God came down on that glorious night. I hear the angels singing, hallelujah, let the earth receive her King. I know that love has come, sing it out.
Give me a little bit of time to get from the tangled up, I've kind of got headphones and leaves tangled around my neck. Yesterday I was climbing in the woods and I fell, crash. I think maybe I'm kind of, anyway, I should behave myself better. It's great to see you. If you're here for the very first time, again, if you've arrived during our opening worship, I'd love it to be with you. And at the 9:15 service, we had an absolutely amazing Chris Dingle service. The room was full of families. We had oranges and candles, sweets. No one was injured or damaged very severely. And yet we managed to turn it all around and create a space for you. So thank you for all the team who've really helped us to do that. So just today, just to let you know where we're going to go as a church, first of all, in a few moments, our young people are going to go to groups that are specially for them. And I'd like to invite Laura, our children's minister, and Joe, our youth minister, just to come and tell us what's going to be going on with young people today.
Thanks, Dave. Yes, in children's groups this month, we are in Christmas mood, Christmas mode even, which is very exciting. Can I have a whoop? A bit louder than that, come on. That's better. Well done. So it's very exciting. So if your child is Bright Lights or Junior Explorers, you're going to be going upstairs. You're going to have a go at making some Christingles. So if you felt like you missed out, you're not. It's going to be amazing. Next week, we're having Christmas parties in all of our groups. So I'd love to encourage you parents to please book your children's tickets for that online. And if they do football, we're having a Christmas special football edition group next week, which is going to be very exciting.
Great. Yeah, Devotion is our group for young people. We meet out there in a minute and then we walk to ADH, about 5 minutes away. And this morning we are sadly not doing Christmas stuff quite yet, maybe next week. But we're looking at threads in the Bible and storylines in the Bible and how they all point to Jesus. And we've got the Moses storyline today. So yeah.
Very theological stuff. Well done, Joe. Now, it is the season of Advent, as you know, and that's a time of preparation. Preparation, we look backwards, actually, and we think about the time when we're preparing for Jesus' first coming, but we're also looking forward, thinking about, when we think about living the light of Jesus' return, and every Sunday we light an Advent candle. In fact, we light a number every week, so it's two today, and Ali, Ung and Karis, I think, are going to come and light a candle for us and do a prayer. So let's give them a little welcome as they come up on the stage.
In the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored, the Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will be with child and give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High One will shadow over you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who was said to be barren is in her sixth month, for nothing is impossible with God." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May it be to me as you have said." Then the angel left her.
Right, now, are you both going to light candles today? We're going to hope that those lighters work. They worked okay at 9:15. We've got fire. Yes, well done. Thank you so much. Well done. So we're going to let our young people go through groups in just a minute, and that will be your cue if you haven't got young children that you're taking to various places or shepherding out of the building to say hello to your neighbours. And if you're happy to, just to greet people nearby you, that'll be brilliant. So here's your cue to be friendly. You've been very friendly. I'm going to call you back now. Is that all right? Well done. So again, if you're here watching online and you've not really connected with Woodlands, or if you're here in the building and you've not connected with us and you're brand new, you are very important. In fact, you're some of the most important people, because part of the reason we exist as a church is to welcome people, to create a space in God's family to say you can belong and be part of us. And so actually in a moment or two, there's going to be a QR code that's going to come up on the screen. Is it coming? And there it is, look. And if you point your phone at that and click, then that'll take you to a page where you can give us your details, and we will be able to then connect you. And we'll write to you and tell you about how you can get involved with our newcomers process if you'd like to. Alternatively, you can meet some of our newcomers team in the foyer, and they'd love just to kind of connect you. It doesn't commit you to anything, but it does mean that we can write to you, let you know more about how you can get connected to us. And by the way, I do send out an email every week, and I reckon that probably about half of them end up in people's spam folders, because they certainly end up in mine. My own emails go to my own spam folder. So if you've not heard from me and you'd like to, do check your spam folder, and that might give you a clue to what's going on. Now, the big news for us at Woodlands at the moment is Christmas is coming. Well, in fact, it's not really coming. It's kind of started, really. The season is here. We've had our Chris Dingle service. And next week, it seems all too soon, but we are going to have carols by candlelight. And a big thanks to Melissa and Joe and the team who helped decorate the church and make it look really fantastic, ready for all of our Christmas services. So we'll just show you a little Christmas promo video, actually, just to whet your appetite even further, if that can roll now. Fantastic. A lot to get excited about. And just to remind you that some of the services need to be booked, particularly Saturday evening carols by candlelight next Saturday, so that we can make a really COVID-safe area for people who are a little bit cautious about coming out. And also Christmas Day, because it gets rammed. We do want to have a full church, but we don't want to have to turn people away on Christmas Day. So we would love you to book for that service. But do check out the website for more details about everything. Again, in family news, Catherine Peel's here. It was lovely last Tuesday just to say goodbye to her mum, Val, and to have a wonderful service just to say how much we appreciated Val being part of our church family. And so thank you for sharing that time with us, Catherine. And just to let you know, a couple of people in our church family are very, very poorly at the moment. David Webb, who's perhaps our oldest member, 92, has had a heart attack and he's in hospital. And also Nettie's dad is had multiple organ failure. He just really is passing away. And just be remembering that family in your prayers right now. But what we're going to do as we continue with our service is take a little bit more time to worship. Before I introduce you to our guest speaker, he's not really a guest because he's part of the family, the Woodlands family, but Philip Jinadu, who's normally at Metro and leading the church there, is going to be our guest speaker this morning. But I'm going to pray again. We're going to go back into worship. Father God, we thank you that in our joys and sorrows, you're with us. Thank you, God, for Val. We just remember her today, and we thank you for her life. Father God, we thank you for David and for Malcolm, who are at a critical time in their lives right now. We ask for your blessing on them. I want to ask the Lord God for your blessing on our children, young people, as they're in their groups and as they're themselves caught up in a world which is really challenging as well as full of hope and potential. We pray, Lord God, that your spirit would guide us and that you guide us in our service now. We'd be able to listen to you and follow you more clearly. Amen.
Why don't we stand together?
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies till all my fears are gone.
My mother's womb.
From my mother's womb, oh, you have chosen me, and love has called my name, and I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins, and I'm not.
Surrounded.
We believe.
We are your sons and daughters, Lord. We are here for you. We are made for you, for your glory, for your worship. When you come, when you are here, when you meet with us, we have no need to fear, no need to worry, no need to strive, no need to be caught up in the hustle and bustle and busyness of everyday life. For we know that you are victorious. You are our Savior. You are our Father and our friend. Thank you, Lord, that we have no need to fear. We have no need for anxieties, for you are in control. You are our God. You are our comfort. You are our Redeemer. You are our help in times of need. You are our strength, our fortress. You are our rest. You are our peace. In this time, we sing of you being the Prince of Peace, for all peace comes from you, Lord. And so we thank you and we glorify you. You are the Word.
You are the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High, with hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is.
beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King.
What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus.
What a beautiful name it is. The
not because of our history as a church, but because of your history, because of you coming, of us being followers of Jesus. Say, Jesus, you're the name above every other name. We welcome you. We honour you. We bow before you. You came into our world, a light that shone in the darkness, and yet coming in humility and vulnerability, and today you're coming among us by your Spirit. We sense your presence here as we worship you. Amen. Do take your seats. I've already welcomed Philip, but here he is. He's going to come and share to us in the first of our series, which is a little series based on the name Emmanuel, which means God with us. So over to you, Philip.
Thanks. Morning, everyone. So good to be back. It's great to be a guest speaker in Woodlands. Many of you won't know me. My wife, Kate, and I, we lead and help lead the metro part of Woodlands in the harbour side. A church that meets in the evenings. We particularly concentrate on the 20s and 30s. You probably know the stats. Bristol has one of the highest percentages of people in their 20s in the whole country, and yet less than 1% of people in their 20s have any connection with church. We know this, and we're committed to seeing our city reached again with the love of Jesus. Amen. But it's great to come back to Woodlands. I've forgotten just how incredibly hot it is in this church. I've just been taken off more and more layers as I've come in here. So apologies if I'm a little bit underdressed. But we're looking at the run-up to Christmas. And if you are familiar with the Christmas story, you'll know that the four Gospels give us different accounts in different ways. In John, it's just one verse, the Word became flesh. In Mark, it's complete blank. Matthew and Luke give us a bit more of a developed story of how the Messiah is born. But actually, the story begins hundreds of years earlier. And I want us to look and concentrate on a prophetic word that was given by Isaiah, the prophet, around about 700 years before Jesus is born. And I don't know about you, but for me, in this time of coronavirus, I have found new resonance in Scripture. I am feeling things that I've never felt before. Certain parts of the Bible are becoming more relevant than they've ever been for me before, because our situation has changed. You know, it's easy to love God and to serve God and to follow God when you are living in an affluent society where you have no cares, no worries, no trauma, no tragedy. But when we're in a time of darkness, when we're in a time of confusion, when we're in a time of pressure, uncertainty, disruption, when we're in a time where we don't know what's coming around the corner, when even right now we're on tenterhooks. I had a text from my daughter. I've got two daughters, one in Dubai, one in Hong Kong. And my Dubai daughter, she sent me a text and it started with bad news. And it turned out to be, you know, she had a bad day at work. But as soon as I get this text, I go into fight and flight mode. I am just on edge. I'm thinking, oh no, does that mean that you can't come back home? We were expecting her back home last Christmas. That didn't happen. Then Easter. That didn't happen. Then summer. That didn't happen. We desperately want to be with our daughter this Christmas. And you're just on edge, waiting for the next piece of bad news. Omicron. How did we get so far down the Greek alphabet? I mean, how much, put your hands up if you've even heard of Omicron before. Okay, a few of you have. The rest of us, we're just like Alpha, Beta, Gamma, Delta, Epsilon. Yeah, that's it. We're down to Omicron. We're nearly at the end. What do we go to next? Ancient Sanskrit? I mean, we are so far gone. This thing has gone so long with such prolonged challenge, such uncertainty. And so the Bible becomes very, very resonant. And so I'd like us to pick up Isaiah's prophecy in Isaiah chapter 9. So let's get that on the screen. Nevertheless, now, a little bit of context. Isaiah chapter 9 comes, and I've studied this, so I don't want to blind you with my great theological knowledge. I wear it lightly. But Isaiah 9 comes after Isaiah 8. Yeah, and I know, it's next level stuff. You don't get to this position without knowing a bit of theology. But it is, it comes after Isaiah 8. And in Isaiah 8, the prophet speaks to the people in the land of Israel, and he says, you're going to be destroyed. You're going to be overcome. You're going to be defeated. The Assyrian army is going to come down and lay waste to you. You'll be all discombobulated. It's just going to be a disaster. But then he says, nevertheless, oh, my giddy aunt, if I ever needed a word from God, it's that one word. I need the word nevertheless. You're in challenging times. You don't know what's going on. Some of us are walking wounded. Some of us are bereaved. Some of us are just at our wits' end. For me, I've had an amazing, fantastic, incredible time in 2021. So many wonderful things happening, and I just cannot wait for it to be over. I'm over this year. I just want it gone. There's been nice things in it, but overall, I felt under pressure, and I felt myself at breaking point. I need the word nevertheless. Everyone say, nevertheless. Nevertheless. Okay, let's carry on. Nevertheless, there will be no more gloom for those who were in distress. Oh, my Lord. In the past, he humbled the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, but in the future, he will honor Galilee of the nations by the way of the sea beyond the Jordan. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you. As people rejoice at the harvest, as warriors rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle, every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given. And the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. Nevertheless, in a time of gloom, in a time of distress, in a time of darkness, God speaks hope into our lives. And that's what we want to hear this morning. That's what we want to hear as we go into a time of Christmas. It's no longer enough to have a twee Christmas where we just fall back on the old traditions and the kind of the festive frivolities. I need a Christmas that brings to me a deep-rooted, hard-fought, highly divine sense of hope. I want light within the darkness. Now, here's a question for you, and I want you to think about this question. Why, oh why, oh why, does he prophesy about the land of Zebulun and Naphtali? Now, Isaiah is a prophet based in Judah. He's of the tribe of Judah. He is in the southern kingdom. A little bit of backstory for you. The Israelite people, they had a king. That king, Saul, took over, and then David became king and his son Solomon. But then the whole kingdom fractured in two. You had the southern kingdom of Judah, you had the northern kingdom of Israel with their sort of capital in Samaria. And Isaiah speaks 200 years into this fracture of the country. And it has been, by and large, just to put it in simplistic terms, Judah good, Israel bad. South, kind of patchy, but passable. North, absolute disaster, a wrecking ball. And they have had 200 years in the northern kingdom of idolatry, of unfaithfulness to Yahweh. They have been utterly, completely off the grid. And Israel is now approaching judgment. That's why the Assyrian army is going to come. It's just a consequence of living outside a covenant with God. And yet this prophet speaks about a savior that will come. Isaiah's whole name. His name literally means Yahweh's salvation. God saves. And he's down in the kind of the good Judean part of the kingdom. And yet he speaks to the northern kingdom and he speaks judgment. And I get that. I understand that he would speak judgment because they deserve judgment. They deserve to suffer the consequences of their bad choices and their broken rulership. But what I don't understand is why he should talk about the son of, well, the son of David. Why they should prophesy a Messiah would come out of the line of King David, the Judean king based in Jerusalem. Why should they start talking about the Messiah being in the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali? When you think about Jesus, we think about Jesus' hometown. Which hometown? Jesus of Nazareth? Why? Why is it Jesus of Nazareth? Why was Jesus, I mean, which sea is he beside? The Sea of Galilee. Why? Why the Sea of Galilee? Why not the Dead Sea, a bit closer to where Jerusalem is and the south is? Why is it the land of Naphtali? Why is it the town of Nazareth? Why not Bethlehem? You know, Isaiah is there and he's prophesying 700 years before the birth of Christ, the Messiah that is to come. And he has a best buddy, a friend, a contemporary called Micah. Everyone say Micah. Micah and Isaiah hang around at the same parties, got the same friends, they do the same things together on the same netball team. And Micah has this prophetic word about the Messiah. And he says, Micah chapter 5, verse 2, he says, "But you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, although you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me a ruler over my people Israel, whose origins are of old, from ancient times." Micah drops the mic and says, it's going to be the Messiah is going to come from Bethlehem Ephrathah. Check it out. Because that makes sense. Because Bethlehem is the city of David. It's the town of David. It's where David was brought up. And God has made these royal promises to David that one day your son will have a rule that will never end. And then Isaiah picks up in the rap battle and he says, yo, no. There's going to come a ruler. Yes, he is going to be the son of David. Yes, but it's the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. And Micah says, you're crazy. What are you talking about? These people are absolutely far gone. And Isaiah says, that is the point. Those walking in darkness have seen a great light. And Isaiah prophesies about the nation of Israel who is so far away from God's perfect purposes for their lives. And he says, you're going to suffer the consequences and you're going to be judged and it's going to be grim. It's going to be awful. And that thing that happened to the northern kingdom, it was a slow death. It was a death by a thousand cuts. It took years. It was like a crumbling of the nations. The Assyrians came and took more and more and more and more. And they started where? They started in the land of Zebulun and Naphtali. And then over the next 10, 15, 20 years, they came further down until they took Samaria itself. And then the whole nation was carried off and obliterated. And Zebulun and Naphtali were in the first wave, the front wave, the front line of the collapse and the crumble of God's people. This kind of traumatic holocaust that happens with the nation. And yet it's to those people that Isaiah says, this is what God is like. This is what God is like. He makes a covenant to David, and he says, yes, out of you, Bethlehem. And Micah, love your work, big fan, great, keep it up. And you're not wrong. In fact, I'm going to engineer it in 700 years' time. I'm going to engineer it so that the son of David is indeed born in Bethlehem. But then I'm going to move him to the land of Zebulun, the land of Naphtali. If you know your biblical geography, Nazareth is in the ancient land of Zebulun. Jesus is brought up there. He lives there. That's where he has his childhood and becomes a young man. When he's 30 years old, as he starts his ministry, he moves because it gets a little bit hot in Nazareth. And it's not a particularly, it's a rubbish town, let's face it. It's basically just a pub and a few houses. And he moves to another more central, more cosmopolitan city, the city of Capernaum, which is in the land of Naphtali, from Zebulun to Naphtali. And he is living there. Why? Why is Jesus there? Why is Jesus by the Sea of Galilee? Why is Jesus with Galileans? Why does Jesus always have to explain himself when he's in Jerusalem and people are saying, Galilee? You're kidding me? Can anything good come out of Galilee? I don't see it. I'm sorry. You know, Galilee, bad. Land of Zebulun, land of Naphtali, great darkness. But God says this, even though your darkness has caused you pain and trauma and suffering, my light is going to come to the darkness. I could easily just place the Messiah in Bethlehem and have him all the way there and just forget you. Forget you in the north, forget you with your unfaithfulness and your lack of devotion to me. But he says, no, the people that are the most in darkness, the people that have most messed up, that is where I am going to incarnate my presence. And Isaiah speaks, and I can't imagine what it's like for the prophet, because he speaks in words that are human, but then have these inexplicably divine overtones. And so he says, unto us a child is born. That makes sense. It makes sense. Human children are born. A human being is going to be born. But then he says it again, but in a different way. He says, unto us a child is born, yes, but unto us a son is given. You mean like given as in the sense of given birth to? Well, why are you saying it in two different ways? And he has no idea that in 700 years plus time, a young man is going to sit in front of a prominent Pharisee and say these words, for God so loved the world, he gave his only son. Unto us a son is given. A son who's been from everlasting to everlasting. A son whose origins are of old, from everlasting. A son who is given and yet a son who is born. A son who is fully human and yet a son who has always been the divine God, the Son, from age beyond age. And Isaiah says, he's going to be a wonderful counselor. He's going to be the person that's going to lead us by the hand and take us and show us the way forward. But he's also going to be Almighty God. And Isaiah's writing this down on the scroll, and he's just writing what he's given. He's thinking, I don't get this. He's a counselor, and yet he's God. How can God be a child that is born, a son that is given? And then he says, he'll be the everlasting Father. All my life, for so long, I thought everlasting father just meant a really old dad. I thought it was like he's always been the father. He's the everlasting father. And it's like he's got the jumper, the bad jokes. He's the everlasting father. Actually, the sense of the words that Isaiah uses is literally, he will be the father of eternity. Now, he is the source of all reality. He is the source of time itself. He is the very wellspring of eternity. He is the creator, God, and he's the prince of peace. And he comes to those walking in darkness. About a month ago in Metro, we had a baptism service. We baptized three people, all of whom were atheists. I say they were atheists. They weren't atheists when we baptized them. That would be kind of an imposition. They had all come to faith. This was a voluntary thing. But they had all come from a position of atheism. One person, a girl, she said, I was not only atheistic, but I was aggressively, angrily atheist. And I would rip pieces out of any Christian that tried to share their story with me. I was angry and I did not believe in God. But she talked about how she got to the very, very end of herself, to the very worst point, to the moment of deepest darkness. And in that deep darkness, the one living in great darkness saw a great light. At her very lowest ebb, when she was at a crisis moment in her life, she cried out and prayed a prayer to a God she did not even believe in. And she heard a voice, clear as day, say to her, you're going to be okay. And she told me, she said, I heard this voice, I didn't believe in it, but I thought I owe it to myself to investigate. So she Googled, found us, started watching online, did an alpha course online, and then we baptized her, and she's now a wonderful part of the church. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. One other guy that we baptized, atheist again, but a remarkable experience with the Holy Spirit. When we baptized him, he came out of the water, and he was just trembling from head to toe, trembling. And I thought, it wasn't that cold. But something was happening. And so I placed my hand on his head and I began to pray and prophesy over him. And then afterwards, I said, how was it? And he said, I had the most weird experience. I had like an out-of-body experience. I can't explain it. I can't even try. I lost track. He says, all I know is I felt your hand go on my head. And then the next thing I knew, I was climbing out of the pool and everyone was clapping. I said, I prayed for like 3 minutes. He said, yeah, I'll catch up with the video. But this experience of the divine... The other guy that I was just speaking to him at one of our parties last week, and he said, I thought I knew everything that there was to know about Christianity, but when I became a Christian, I realized I didn't know anything. I just knew a slither. He says, do you realize that people at work are talking to me and they're saying, you've changed. You're different. You're not the same person that you used to be. And I'm saying to them, yeah, I have, and I can't explain it other than to say Jesus Christ has saved me. He's a wonderful counselor. He's the mighty God. He's the father of all eternity. He is the prince of peace. If I were God, Isaiah 9 would go differently. It would say, those walking in light have met with the God that they deserve to see in the first place. Those who deserve to have God's favor have been proven right. That's how I would do it, because it just seems fair. But God says, those in darkness, those in despair, those farthest away from me. Listen, if you feel far from God this morning, a great light is dawned for you. If you're watching this online or sometime in the future, you just need to know that no matter how desperate, how dark, how confused, how at sea you feel, there's a great light for you. And for me, as I go into this Christmas time, I feel like more than ever, even more than last year, because last year was this kind of like mega crisis, and I had a lot of adrenaline running around my system, and you know, you step up to the challenges. This year, it's just been like, oh my giddy aunt, seriously, please, let's just know. And I need more than ever, as I feel like I am stumbling in the dark, a darkness of confusion and a difficulty to find where is God and what is happening and what about all the stuff that we were promised and how are we going to navigate all this stuff? In the midst of this, I need an Advent. I need a Christmas that reminds me that those walking in darkness are the very ones to whom the light has come. Let's pray. Just take a moment, wherever you are, online, in the room. Just have a little moment of quiet before God. And just bring your heart, your feelings to your God. Some of you identify with me, feeling at the end of my rope, haggard, worn out, fed up, frustrated, fearful. Others of you are doing better. but you've got loved ones that you know they're walking in darkness. Lord God, we thank you so much for your grace, your kindness. Lord, we thank you that those that walk in darkness have seen a great light. Lord, I thank you that all of us, we live in Zebulun and Naphtali. None of us live the way that we know we should. We're all broken. We're all out of touch. But I want to pray that this Christmas, not only would we see a great light, but I pray that those that we know that are in deep darkness, Lord, on them a light would dawn. I want to pray that we would know Jesus in a greater way than we've ever known Jesus. I pray that we would know him as the wonderful counselor, as mighty God himself, as a source and the father of all eternity and all time and all reality. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. And Lord, we want that light. We want to see Jesus. And I pray now that as we take this moment to go into communion and the Lord's Supper, I pray that we would encounter Jesus in a real way and that we would be light bearers to those around us. I pray that we would be able to give witness, testimony and hope to those who don't know you at Christmas time. In Jesus' name, amen.
But thank you so much for expanding that passage for us and helping us to understand some of that framework. And we're going to respond to what Philip's shared with us by inviting you to share communion with us. And we have, we serve gluten-free bread and grape juice. Hopefully that's going to be something that everybody can participate in. And around the church, there are different stations. You'll see some here at the sides. And in a moment too, when we go back into worship, you'll be invited to come if you'd like to take communion. No one will usher you. It's just make your own way to one of the tables. And if you're watching online, you can find some elements and do this in your own home, actually. That's fine. But when we take communion, there's a number of things that we're doing. We're recognizing, first of all, that we're in a covenant relationship with God, that Jesus gave himself for us and we're giving ourselves back to him. And it may be that for many of you, this is frequent. This is how you recalibrate your Christian life by sharing this meal. But it may be that there are some people here who aren't sure if they are Christians or followers of Jesus, or even if they're able to take communion. I just want to say to you that if today, being here, hearing Philip's message, think about Jesus and his coming, and you think, I would love to follow Jesus. I'd like to make Jesus Lord of my life. I'd like to say yes to him. Then actually for you, taking communion can be, perhaps for the very first time, a way of saying, yes, I want myself to be a Christian. And if that's where you are at today, I'd love it if you would come to one of the tables. Then maybe come and find me or one of the other leaders and just share where you're at so we can support and encourage you in that step. But as we have communion, one of the things that we believe here is that this is a meal where heaven touches earth. It's almost a picture of what's going to happen at the end of all time when the Bible prophesies a kind of great feast where people from every tribe, tongue and nation gather together and God's there and the Lamb of God is there, Jesus is there, and it's like a banquet. We taste some of that and we love it when we have communion. If we can welcome the presence of the future into the now, and for me that means prayer. I love to pray for healing for people around communion. And we'll have some people at the front here. So if you come to one of the tables near the front, after you've had communion, we'll ask you, would you like prayer today? And if you would, then we'll actually, if you don't mind, we'll invite you to, we'll let you say yes or no, but we'll lay hands and pray for you just to know God's blessing, God's healing, to be filled with the Spirit, to be encouraged, anything like that. That's going to be happening as we share communion together. But right now, I'm going to lead us in some prayers, and I'm going to invite you to say an acclamation with you. It's an ancient acclamation of the church. It's in the Book of Common Prayer. It just says this: Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. That is a precis of the gospel. That's what we believe. That's what we affirm day after day. We affirm it to one another. And actually, we're declaring it in the light of all the spiritual invisible powers as well. We're declaring the light of human history, where the world is today and where the world is going. Christ has died, Christ is risen, he will come again. So I'm going to invite you to say that with me loudly, and then to say it wherever you go in the world when you leave here today. So let's pray. Father God, we recognize that, as Philip said, we're like people who've walked in darkness, and we've done things that have hurt you or hurt other people or hurt ourselves. Or we failed to do things that we've been called to do. And we're sorry, Lord God. We ask that you'd forgive us through the blood of Jesus, deliver us from evil, and fill us again with your Holy Spirit. And today, Lord God, we remember that on the night when Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, he broke it, and gave it to his disciples and said, "This is my body given for you." Jesus, the Lamb of God, who was whole, was broken, so that broken people like us could be made whole. And after supper, Jesus took a cup and said, "This is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." And we do remember Jesus died. We do celebrate he's risen and his spirit is here now, which means anything can happen. And we look forward to his coming again. We proclaim his death until he comes. So let's say together, Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And those people who are helping serve, please come. And will you come in your own time to one of the tables?
Come to the nations.
thirsty. Oh, who are thirsty? Oh, who are weak? Come to the fountain. Dip your heart in the streams of life. Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of His mercy. As deep cries out to Thee, oh, come, Lord Jesus. Oh, come, Lord Jesus. Holy Spirit, come. Why don't we all just stand together and let's just sing, Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, have your way in this room.
Release of your Spirit over us, God. Help us to embrace the work that you are doing in our lives, in the lives of the people around us, God, in the lives of those closest to us and within us, Lord. You are always at work. Your hand is moving so mightily. And so we just pray more of your Spirit, God. More of your Spirit. More of your Spirit, God. Right, so this is going to be our last song, guys, and we're just going to continue to invite the Holy Spirit and invite Him to reveal the love of God to us, and the love that is readily available, not just on a Sunday morning, but every moment of our lives. And we just thank you, Lord, and we draw near to you, and we embrace the work that you're doing in our lives. Amen. And draw me close to you. And never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my close to you. And draw me close to you.
Emmanuel, God is with those who walk in darkness. Wherever we walk, Lord God, let us know your presence with us. In Jesus' name, amen. Ladies and gentlemen, that is the formal end of our service. We've got a busy Sunday. We've got Southside meeting in Bedminster. Nikki Pollard, she's there. She's going to be there. So that's our Southside service at 3 o'clock in British Road, Bedminster, if you want to check that out. We've got collect your kids. That's really important because they really have been missing you very much. And tonight, if you're young or young in heart, we've got a younger adult student social before the service in the foyer. So sort of 6 o'clock, there'll be mulled things to drink before our evening service. Thanks for being with us today. Bless you.